It is my pleasure to introduce Professor Balcerowicz. Leszek Balcerowicz is a professor of economics and head of the Department of International Comparative Studies at the Warsaw School of Economics. He is considered the architect of Poland's economic reforms initiated in 1989. He designed and executed the radical stabilization and transformation of the Polish economy after the fall of communism in Poland. In September 1989, Balcerowicz was appointed Deputy Prime Minister of Poland and Minister of Finance in the first post-communist government of Poland. He retained his positions in the government until December 1991. From 1995 to 2000, he was the president of the Freedom Union, a free market-oriented party, and from 1997 to 2000, he was Deputy Prime Minister and Minister of Finance. During 2001-2007, he served his country again as the governor of the Central Bank of Poland. Professor Balcerowicz is the recipient of numerous awards and honors, including the 2014 Milton Friedman Prize for Advancing Liberty and Poland's highest decoration, Order of the White Eagle, for his contribution to the systemic transformation of Poland's economy. He is active as the chairman and founder with the Civil Development Forum Foundation, a think tank based in Warsaw. Professor Balcerowicz, please.
Today I would like to say a few words about, I think, the most important economic issue, which is economic growth. Short term is 1, 2, 3 years. And there is a short term bias in mainstream economics, which is mostly preoccupied with short term growth. And this is called macroeconomics, usually. And there's a lot of debate on what fiscal policy, what monetary policy is good for short-term growth. What matters, really, it's a longer-term growth, meaning 10, 20, 50, 100 years. Why we have this bias in mainstream economics, at least until recently, the short-term bias? Because mainstream economics has largely disregarded differences in institutions or in institutional systems. They usually in the West, as they thought that there is no difference between socialism and capitalism. If you read Samuelson books, which is a Bible, until recently, you can find until recently predictions when the Soviet Union would surpass America. Because they were blind to things which are most important to Adam Smith, differences in institutions. All these mainstream economists just assumed private institutions without doing much research. What does it mean? Competition, private ownership, etc. And they focus on the very superficial level, which can be easily grasp by mathematics. I am not against mathematics, of course, but the use of mathematics should not be guided what is easy. If that were the case in physics, we would not believe in ancient theories. I would say a few words about longer-term growth, which really matters. And this approach, first one should notice that there were huge differences in the rate of longer-term economic growth across time and space. And if you remind yourself of history, then you would remember that the modern economic growth started some 200 or 300 years ago. In Britain, then it spread to some other Western countries. And it was this time when the West started to accelerate and most of the rest of the world stayed behind. Which was the first country, non-Western country, which started to catch up? Japan, in Asia. But it was with 100 years delay. And then in other Asian countries started with even greater delay. We are fascinated by China. But let us remind ourselves that some 500 or 600 years ago, the difference in per capita income between China and the West was rather small. But China is catching up since when? Since 40 years. in an impressive way, but the rate of growth in China is not faster than the previous year, the rate of growth in Japan. Or in South Korea, only China is much bigger. So we are very much impressed. So history tells us that there were huge differences in economic growth. Then even if you look after the Second World War, you see huge growing, very large differences between socialist countries and, say, Western economies. By the way, when I say socialism, I mean what Karl Marx has meant, not social democracy, but the monopoly of state ownership. So socialism in this sense is an extreme form of statism. You have some other forms, you may have regulations, you may have enclaves of state ownership, but socialism was introduced according more or less to what Marx and Lenin has recommended. It was a universal failure. And there are very impressive, very illuminating comparisons. The most extreme is between North and South Korea. The same history, the same culture, two very different systems. In North Korea, as you know, it's an extreme form of Stalinism. And in South Korea, it's export-oriented capitalistic economy. Both countries were equally and desperately poor, still in the 60s. But then there was a huge difference. And in 2003, North Korea had only 7% of South Korean per capita income. So 50 years were enough to produce this, which means institutions matter. And finally, you have differences in countries which are usually called capitalistic, in a sense that there is no ban on private ownership and most of enterprises are private. There are huge differences, which also can be largely reduced or linked to other factors. So we have differences or changes. Now, there's a lot of literature, some literature about the reasons for these large changes in the rate of growth of longer term growth, and you may approach the explanation at three levels. The first level, which is the most superficial, but you should start it, I am coming to that, you look at such factors as innovativeness, employment, etc. The second level is about policies, meaning those who shape reforms, institutional policies. And then you would see that differences in institutions and policies, if they are large and sustained, produce large differences in economic growth. And the third level, which is the deepest one, it's about political economy. What explains differences in policies? And now there are two cases. If you are under dictatorship, you can't do much. Because if dictatorship is very harsh, there would be a few very brave dissidents, but the rest of the population, which is normal, does not dare to challenge the dictatorship. So you would hope that someday it collapses and there are from time to time some nice surprises, like the disillusion of the former Soviet Union, and you never know what is going in this black box of dictator plus his closest supporters or sometimes competitors. But if you are in democracy, like we are now in Central and Eastern Europe, including Poland, Israel, other OECD countries, then what policies are produced depends, I think, on the balance of two kinds of forces. The first kind of force, I call it statist. There are groups which for various reasons press the government to get even bigger in terms of spending, in terms of regulations and various interventions. And within this sector, you have two subgroups. The first are those who just want to get money from other people's pockets or to defend privileges. That's human nature. And they have a strong incentives. And there are always some people in every society who like other people's money. they never say there's other people's money. They say the government, as though government has their own money. And some people believe in it, and they call it social justice. This is a very dangerous word. So this is, and that's normal. You have, by the way, you have also some entrepreneurs or businessmen. They don't like competition. You may have conglomerates who defend their position, but you have also some private individuals who grouped, and whenever they got privileges, they defend them, or they try to get privileges. So this is a rent-seeking war. And rent-seeking is not very good for the economy. The second group are ideological statists. There are lots of individuals who hate free markets. There are lots of them in Hollywood, I already mentioned. You know, there are people, Hollywood, film directors, for example, some of them go to Putin to defend his policies. And there's a lot of books which are in high demand, which present free markets as an invention of devil. And usually the conclusion is the good government, and good government for the status is good by definition. It's just good government, that's it. Have to do something. And in an extreme form, which I called mentality of the Soviet official, they believe whatever problem there is, it is only the state who can and should solve this problem. You know, why did I invent this expression, the mentality of Soviet official? I tell you, there are actual stories. There were visits from the officials from the former Soviet Union to the United States, and they usually were hit by the shock. They seen lots of full chef cars, whiskey, bananas, etc. And the typical question was, what minister is responsible for this? Because they could not grasp that anonymous mechanism, like market, should provide these goods. It had to be a special state intervention, if anything good. This mentality has survived in many countries, including democratic countries. So it has to be undermined. So you have strong status groups in every country, in every free society. And what happens if they are persistently winning? You have either Greece, which is a crisis, a very deep crisis, and then there is a hope for some reforms. And you have Italy or France, meaning stagnation. So accumulation of distortions, limits to competition, rent seeking, etc. So obviously it's better to avoid this sort of outcome. And this is why it is so crucial to strengthen the opposite forces. Call them freedom fighters. But not for external independence, because you don't need it, but for to defend economic freedom. Let me mention that when I look at democratic countries, I see a certain paradox. You can show empirically that a large scope for economic freedom is extremely important for the masses of people, because without economic freedom, you cannot have a sustained rapid economic growth. But it is this freedom exactly which is the most attacked. And the very social slogans, which is anti-social, it's demonized. And this is why economic freedom, even though it's so important for the people, cannot defend itself. It needs stronger and stronger organizations to defend what works. And this is, I am very happy to be here, because I am trying to strengthen these anti-status forces in the society in Poland, and I understand we are trying to do it in Israel. So let us create an international, emulating the socialists for non-socialist purposes. Now let me come to the second level of explanation. So what behind differences in economic growth? And here again we have lots of research, and we have some open questions. First, we know that the most decisive factors are is innovativeness, innovations. I remind you, innovations are not inventions, but application or something new, business model, technology. And as a matter of fact, if you are a catching up country, you rely on technology transfer. In Poland, we've been relying on technology transfer because you have a lot of to borrow, and only later, if your universities are not very mediocre, you allow entry for well-educated people, you get some more and more inventions of your own. But always you rely largely on technology transfer. And the main reason why socialism has lost economic competition with free market economies was that socialism was desperately anti-innovative, desperately. So there was a lot of human capital under socialism. Education system was much, much better than the economic system. But this human capital, especially as far as engineers are concerned, could not be used. So they either emigrated or they lost their capacities. So high level of human capital is necessary, but not sufficient condition for a country to be innovative. Besides, you have a system, what a system? A free market system within the rule of law. Lots of entry, competition, etc. So this is the key. And the socialism was the opposite of such a system. Now, and by far the differences in innovativeness, I think, are the most important reason for differences in the longer term economic growth, but there are some other factors. Employment, which depends in the longer run of demography. I don't think politicians can shape demography, even though they try. You need Mao Zedong to do it in China, but this is not to be recommended. But given demography, say if you are facing aging, like all Western economies, you can still do something to increase employment ratios, like among older people by raising the retirement age, among younger people, if it is low. So in Poland, we still have some reserves. So this is demography and employment policies. What is supposed to be very good for those people who are already employed is very bad for new employment, which is excessive job protection. And this was found out by many investigations. If the private entrepreneurs believe that they cannot dismiss an employee, even though he is not performing well, they would not hire in the first place. So this tends to reduce the demand for labor. And the third factor which differentiates economic growth over the longer run are shocks, especially negative shocks. Events, including crises, which produce a deep and persistent decline in economic growth. Now, I've noticed that whenever people hear the word crisis, they associate it with another word, capitalism. So it is only capitalism which produces crisis. So years and years of teaching of Marxism and Keynesianism, I think, has contributed to this association. But if you look more broadly to the world, you see that the deepest crisis, in a sense of, as I said, the deeper breakdowns in economic growth has happened not in market systems, but in non-market systems with a heavy concentration of political power. Because if you have a heavy concentration of political power, there are no constraints, external constraints, to what the ruler can do. And if the ruler is a psychopath, which happens among absolute rulers, you have a catastrophe. You may have an economic catastrophe which is associated with genocide. And this is not a theory. It has happened under Stalin, when you have millions of people who are either killed or starved to hunger, like in Ukraine. It has happened under Mao Zedong, who had lots of follies how to accelerate economic growth. As a result of his follies or policies, some 50 million people died under Mao, not to mention Khmer Rouge, Red Khmer, a genocide and economic catastrophe. So the best protection against really deep crisis is the limitation on political power. if a power is too excessive. And this is why the movement from the rule of law or constitutionalism is also extremely important economic reform. It's not only political. By the way, the most important reforms for the economy are usually reforms in the political sphere. Because most problems, economic problems, are produced by a bad state, which usually means excessive state power, political power. Of course, another problem is that you may have what is called failed state, or in other words, no state. So some basic functions of the state are not being performed, so there is no protection of person's life and property, and there is no investment. Like in Haiti, at least until recently. But I think there are much more often instances when you have have a bad state because intervenes too much. So I think this would be, what about crisis in market economies? Let me mention only briefly this. And there is, I am going to mention it because I think there's a lot of cliches or even myth about the reasons of the crisis in market economies, or more broadly, non-socialist economies. And I think the widespread interpretation regarding also the recent crisis, what was called the recent global crisis, is the market failure. So some faults in the markets, including greedy bankers, which have produced the crisis. This is a popular interpretation. I am not saying that some markets are not excessively greedy, but demonization is not an explanation. And so easy to demonize. So if you look much more deeply, and first of all, you distinguish between two types of crisis recently. The one is fiscal crisis, excessive fiscal spending over many years at the cost of increased borrowing, a growing public debt. Call it the Greek drama. Is it free market crisis? Governments are not markets, so it is clearly politically driven. And one of the most important and very difficult tasks for liberally minded people in every society is to constrain the government on the fiscal side. And those who want the state to spend more usually are using very tempting slogans. Social justice, poverty, etc. And one has to diffuse this. One has to be better in communication than the statist. Hire some satirists. I do it in Poland. You cannot be only serious. You have to be sharp to undermine slogans. Okay. Now, what about such crises like in Ireland? So it's a private credit boom. Or in Spain. Or in Britain, outside the Eurozone. The popular explanation is that for sure, this must be, since you have excessive growth of credit in the private markets, it must be the private markets which are to blame. But is it so obvious? It's so obvious as to say, you have sneezing in your nose, so it is the nose who is the reason for the sneezing. Is it really logical? It's not necessary. The place when you have a problem is not necessarily the reason for the problem. Yeah. So if you dig deeper, you see a lot of policies which have contributed, which have distorted the functioning of the financial markets, buyers and sellers, and contributed to a credit boom. For just an example, too big to fail. We've heard this expression that some financial institutions were too big to be allowed to go bust, so there were interventions. It started some 40, 50 years ago. And once this policy starts, the financial markets, the creditors assume that it is less risky to lend to big institutions than to the small one, because big institutions are not allowed to fail. The result is that big institutions are getting cheaper financing and they are getting even bigger. So this is certainly a product of failed or wrong policies. And there are many, many others, policies like subsidizing the mortgage credit, which is a very popular. You say you're helping the young, you subsidize. the policies, or tax treatment of debt versus equity. So it pays more in many countries to just to borrow than to increase the equity capital. And that's at least 10 various policies. I would like to leave you only with the thought that financial crises are not necessarily a market failure, and in fact that behind financial crises you usually find a combination of bad but popular policies. Popular policies are usually bad. I am not saying every good policy is non-popular, but some policies. And this is a problem for the non-state side to unmask these popular policies, to show the cost. So this was the introduction, some general remarks about economic growth, first level, third level, second level, third level. And now let me mention a few things about Europe. Now, first of all, you can see that compared to the US, in the longer run, Europe was converging, so approaching the per capita level of the US, but this convergence process, as you can see, has stopped in 1980. And then there was a divergence, meaning that in aggregate, the European countries were growing slower than the United States. And there is a lot of research why. A reason which was found in the research was that Americans tend to work longer hours while Europeans have reduced the working hours, partly because of tax policies. But as you know, aggregates are only the first approximation and they hide a lot of variation. So I show you the variation. This would be the next. Now this shows the variation. Well, this shows, for example, that Italy in 1980 had more than 70% of per capita income of the US, but in 2012 it had less than 60%. Yes. So this measure, this shows what percentage of US GDP has Italy in 1980. And if you look at this vertical axis, you see that 2012 and 2013, more or less now, it has only 60%, so it was divergent. Is it clear or not? Okay. Greece had almost 50% in 1980, and now it has 40%. Greece, by the way, it's an example of spectacular decline in GDP for the last 5-6 years. And there's a lot of debate about the reasons. We can come to that. Germany, surprisingly, you may still say, it had more than 85 in 1980, and now it has less than, it's about 70%. So German success is only recent. And there are still many problems in Germany, surprisingly. But there are some countries. Ireland, despite the recent crisis, is an example of a spectacular success. Look, Ireland had slightly more than 40% of American per capita income in 1980, and now it has almost 80%. And not surprisingly, there are many debates why. What's behind Irish success? I leave it to the discussion. Sweden had a little more in 2012 than in 1980. Let me say it is not because of the Swedish model, old-fashioned Swedish model. We can't do that because Swedish model was very much reformed after the crisis in the late 80s. And in some respect, there is more economic freedom in Sweden than in the United States. So there are liberal reforms in Sweden. And they also reduce the burden of taxation. Austria, perhaps surprisingly, has fared better than Germany. United Kingdom, under recently, mostly thanks to Mrs. Thatcher, empirically speaking. Because before Thatcher reforms, Britain was a weak and sick man of Europe, and then it accelerated, and the wisdom of Blair was that he has not dismantled Thatcher reforms. And in some respects, he did some more reforms. So there are differences, and what's most interesting, there are differences. Why that the differences? I am not, have no time to explain to it. We can come to the discussion, but mostly behind accelerations, that if you look at the respective countries in the perspective of, say, 50 years' time, 40 years' time, then you see that in every country you find episodes of growth accelerations and growth slowdowns. I am speaking about growth accelerations and growth slowdowns which go beyond normal recessions and recovery from the recessions. And here are examples of, you can find it in my paper where I sent you about growth acceleration, and we have done some research. Let me show that if you are interested in more on that, this is the recent book which is available free of charge in the non-market institution which is called World Bank. And they published a set of studies which I have with my student done on the differences in economic growth between some selected pairs of countries. For example, one, why Mexico has lagged behind Spain for the last 50 years, etc. So, okay. So I'm not going to go deeper, but what behind accelerations? You have two main reasons. One is bad. You have a boom. And during a boom, growth accelerates, everybody is happy, but usually booms turns into the bust, and then you have a slowdown. What are the good accelerations? If you improve the macroeconomic and institutional framework for economic growth, this is called usually reforms. This is what we did in Poland. Let me make a short digression. In Poland, we have a bankrupted socialism in 1989, and hyperinflation, like you had in Israel before Michael Bruno. And we introduced a comprehensive staff program which brought down inflation, but also enlarged economic freedom, introduced competition, and privatized the economy through new entry and turning state-owned enterprises into the private ones. This, the last step, of course, took more time than just opening the economy. And if you compared this radical strategy, which was also applied in the Baltic countries, to non-radical strategies, like in Russia or in Ukraine, you see huge differences. In 1989, the per capita income in Poland and in Ukraine were more or less similar. Now the per capita income in Poland is three times as high as in Ukraine. So delay in reforms is very costly. I'm saying this because the cliché is reforms are painful. But what about the non-reforms? They are much more painful. So language hides lots of traps. Reforms are painful. They never mention the cost of painful and non-reforms. Okay, this was a digression. So, now also a huge differences have occurred during the global economic crisis, and we turn to another. No, let me turn to the first. By the way, behind slowdowns, you have bubbles which burst. So you pay the price for accelerated growth, or you have deterioration in the framework for economic activity. It is what has happened under Putin. Perhaps it is worth doing a digression. What has happened under Putin? Now, Putin was very lucky because he assumed power when things could get only better. Only better. This was a crisis. Very low levels of prices of gas and oil, and when he started, economy in a natural way recovered. And prices of oil and gas went up. So the standard of living has increased too, has been increasing too, And quite understandably, he was very popular. And people thought he's a very good ruler. And he continued along the previous line for more than 3 years, and then he changed track. And gradually he has destroyed what under Yeltsin has been built. First, democracy. Democracy is a political competition. Democracy without competition is a sham democracy. So you have democracy without competition under Putin, so you know who is going to win. This is sham democracy. Remember, democracy are not these very nice words, rule of the people. It's competition in the political sphere, competition. So for that you need what? Civil rights. You have to be able to compete. Media access, freedom of association, freedom of assembly, etc., etc. Okay, so he destroyed it. Then there were the beginnings of the building of the rule of law. And he undermined it. What is the opposite to the rule of law? The rule of KGB. The rule of secret police, the opposite. So under Yeltsin, I think he was a great guy. I met him several times, he was a great guy. He dismantled, he divided the inherited KGB into three organizations. Under Putin, they were amalgamated and they were added powers. And third, he has weakened economy in three ways. First, by politicization. And you politicize economy whenever you have a state sector. Because unavoidably, I think, state ownership means that the ultimate rulers are the politicians who can dismiss the managers. But second, under Putin, he introduced what I called a temporary private ownership. You never know how long you are going to be an owner. In what way? If you have good connections to Putin and KGB, you can destroy your competitor. But you have a weaker connections, you are going to be destroyed. And you never know. So under this system, there are no incentives to invest. There are incentives for the capital flight. And finally, the financial sector in Russia was fragile because they have to lend, borrow from the government. So even before Putin's aggression against Ukraine, Russian economy has faced stagnation. And with this sort of the economic model, I don't think they can grow. Which means that plus the decline in the prices of oil, some sanctions, it means that I think Putin is going to face growing dilemmas to spend on military and to spend on pensions. Okay, this was a digression. So you can make worse the framework for private activity and then economic growth suffers. Turning to, now let me finish with saying a few words about what has happened in the European countries during the so-called global financial crisis, okay? And I have a table. And the story is, again, huge differentiation. So there is no one Europe. There are different countries, yes. For the level in 2014, of Poland's GDP was more than 18% higher than it was in 2008. At the opposite end, you have Greece. When it was lower, yes, by almost 25%. So huge, huge differences. And who are the top countries from the top? Yes, you may skip Malta, it's too small. But you have Baltic countries, Lithuania, Latvia, Estonia. By the way, the leaders are almost all the new members of the European Union, except for Malta. What's interesting is that in the Baltic countries, they have a huge boom, which went bust. And in the first year, they suffered deep declines in GDP, but they recovered. Why? Because they were not Greece. So introduced different policy. In Greece, they were trying to delay what was necessary, structural reforms or reducing spending through reforms. In the Baltics, they did it. very quickly, they paid the price in the 1 year, then they recovered, and now they are growth leaders in European Union. While in Greece, as I said, they were trying to delay the most important things. And cumulatively, they suffered a decline of almost 25%. As you can see, there are also differences in other countries. You see some large countries of the Eurozone, Italy and France, which are stagnating, more Italy than France, but France is now, I think, a big problem. And some relative winners like Sweden, which has, or Germany. But even Germany, if you look a bit closer, has some reforms to do. They are overregulated. We may come to that. Maybe we are interested in that. Let me finish by saying, what you can distinguish some problem countries in the Eurozone. I am now coming to the Eurozone. Eurozone meaning countries having the common currency called Euro. And there are two groups of the problem countries. Those who suffered boom-bust period and did not recover. And one of them is Greece, an extreme example, but there's also, to some extent, Spain. Ireland is doing better, but it certainly was a problem country. And the second group are countries which did not have the boom-bust episode, but accumulated a lot of distortions. So their economic growth over time has been declining until stagnation. And there is, of course, an obvious question is why. And why, I think one can show empirically that one of the reasons is they got a lot of cheap money. We like cheap money, but it's very dangerous to societies. Now, those countries which have suffered the boom bust, they were getting a very cheap credit thanks to entry in the Eurozone. So they started to pay much less than before. While Germany, who was disciplined even before entering the Eurozone, did not get these windfall gains. And windfall gains are very tempting in the private lives and especially among the politicians. Instead of using this to reduce debt, they use it to increase spending. And this is what happened in the problem countries. And Italy and France, they did not suffer boom-bust episode, but instead they used the cheap money not to do fiscal reforms and the regulatory reforms which were necessary. So the common denominator for these two groups of countries is that very cheap credit is risky, which leads to delays. And the last point which I want to cover, I was not warned that I am speaking too long, but I am not going to continue for more than 3 minutes. There's a big debate. What policies, given the financial crisis, what policies were necessary and desirable to get the respective European countries after the problems? This is a huge debate, so I have to cut it short. And I think there's, again, a lot of confusion. First, there's a talk about European solutions. That should be European solutions. But what are the European solutions for the French problems? The Germans who subsidize France via Brussels? What are the European solutions to the Italian problems? There are no European solutions to the French problems or Italian problems, but there are French solutions to the French problems. Or the Italian solutions to the Italian problems, and the name for the solutions are structural reforms. Meaning they have to finally to deregulate the economy, if necessary to privatize the economy. And when they are getting, the only European solution is double-edged, which is unconventional monetary policy by the European Central Bank. Because if the politicians get cheap credit, they delay reforms. It is very interesting to hear what Mr. Draghi is saying. First, he's saying monetary policy cannot substitute the reforms. Then he prints money. Then he weakens the incentives for the reforms. Then the economic situation does not improve. So there is a second round. Mr. Draghi is saying, monetary policy cannot substitute for the reforms. There's a bad situation. So he prints money again. I don't want to be unfair, because let me say that if there's any rationale for this continued, extremely easy monetary policy, I think, which has started by Fed, it is competitive depreciation. And we are watching this. When Fed started quantitative easing, or in normal words, printing money, and has lowered and maintained interest rates, over some time this contributed to a weaker dollar, so you have a depreciation. Then after a while there was a response in Japan, which was praised as Abenomics, but we are still looking for the third arrow. Where is the third arrow? Third arrow was the name of four reforms. There are only two first arrows. And then finally, when euro appreciated against weaker dollar, we have now an attempt to weaken euro, which is psychologically understandable. This means that dollar is getting, it's much stronger than in the past. So I'm just waiting when Fed responds. What would be the first response? So this is a policy which have been started, I think, by Fed, and to a large extent Fed has been dictating the world monetary policy, which cannot substitute for the solutions of the real problems, which are mostly on the supply side. And with that, let me end my prolonged presentation. And let us pass transit to the most interesting part, which is a discussion. Thank you.
And I wanted to ask you about this new monster that we have, the deflation, that everyone is warning about it, and it seems like and it connects to the quantitative easing. It seems like a race to the bottom, because everyone is fighting us with deflation and printing money and want to cause inflation and depreciate the currency. But when we look at what the Swiss Central Bank did, they left out the game, and it seems that they weren't harmed by it. So why not more countries do this policy and stop this currency war and depreciation and being afraid of deflation?
Well, that's a very topical issue we just discussed. Let me remind you the title of a very good paper written by some good people in BIS. This is Bank for International Settlement in Basel. The title was Good Inflation, Bad Inflation, and Ugly Deflation. Now, if you listen to the media, financial media, and to the mainstream economists and central bankers, you would think that every deflation is ugly. But it's not the case. Ugly meaning that it's a catastrophe, that it produces a persistent decline in GDP, etc. Now, this one-sided story does not fit historical facts. To my knowledge, the only documented case of ugly or bad deflation was the Great Depression. But what produced the decline, and even here I think deflation was a symptom and not the reason for the decline. The reason was a collapse of the banking sector, financial sector, which meant a collapse of credit, which meant a collapse of demand. And as a result, you have declining prices. But the reason was a decline, the financial catastrophe. But the opposite is when it's what we call a positive supply shock, meaning some prices, important prices, are getting lower. Like nowadays, energy prices, foodstuffs. What is the normal response of consumers? They have more purchasing power to spend on other goods. They usually spend more on other goods. So demand, spending is growing. And this has been shown recently in Europe. It's the case in Poland. Some people say, no, this cannot be the case, because people would expect falling prices in the future, so they would postpone the spending, waiting for prices being even lower. But this is a nonsense. What will postpone buying food expect you would starve and you would go get cheaper food. Even consumer goods, you do not delay in a regular way the purchases. And as a result, the statement that falling deflation produces, unavoidably produces a decline in spending, as a general statement, is false. And it was proven false recently. I don't enter the psychology of central bankers. They may be subjectively convinced they are rescuing the world from another catastrophe. I am saying about what one can observe. I don't think we are facing an ugly deflation now. We don't have now a collapse of the financial sector. We have some lower prices of some important goods, which tends to produce increased purchases of other goods. I don't think one can show that falling prices would continue for the longer run. If you have one-time factors, one should not assume that these one-time factors would be repeated over time. So this is my opinion. My opinion is that this is a pretext for some central bankers to print money or engage in non-conventional monetary policy, while probably the true reason is to weaken their currencies, to get currencies weaker. But they cannot confess publicly, I want euro to be weaker. So they have to say, are you fighting the great enemy, the devil, called deflation?
Can you elaborate about what you think is the future of Europe and the EU in general?
That's a big question. I don't think, I think the problem of, let me take first Eurozone, yes? Because this is the core. As I said, there are no European policies which could solve the problems of some countries. So if there's a question of the future of the Eurozone, it will be decided in France or in Italy, because these are large countries, and only large countries can produce large externalities, including negative effects. And it is encouraging that even in France they started to not only speak but also trying to do some reforms. This is good for France, it continues good for Eurozone. The same goes for Italy. With respect to Greece, these are opposite risk. One risk is, and this is publicized, if Greece leaves Eurozone. Well, you can only speculate about the consequences, but I don't think they would be very dramatic, extremely dramatic. Another risk would be if new government in Greece is de facto subsidized. So if they do not maintain or introduce reforms which are necessary for Greece, but get, for some reasons, a new credit. There would be a political backlash in countries like, starting from Germany, Netherlands, Slovakia. The Slovaks would ask, why should we subsidize Greeks, which are richest than we are? And it's interesting to watch what Mrs. Merkel and some other leaders would do. They have to choose, they cannot avoid the risk here. Personally, I would tend to choose the risk that Greece leaves and be subsidized by Putin. Yes.
Can you please say a bit more about the rule of communications in structural reforms?
Well, let me say there are two different political situations. Reforms. The one, we have this in Poland between 89 and say 91. I called it the period of extraordinary politics, which is good for reforms. In this period, it was like that Poland became liberated, so it was a lot of euphoria. And most Poles realized that it was economic catastrophes, so they were more ready than normal not to protest. To support even radical reform. And what was the best strategy? Not to waste too much time on PR, but do reforms. So speed was of essence, if, of course, speed of the movement in the right direction. And fortunately in Poland, by chance, we are more or less prepared, because I had a hobby even in the late 70s. I was interested in reforms, even though I did not dream that this would be useful for Poland, but by chance factor it became so. More or less have useless hobbies from time to time. It may be useful. Okay, so speed. It was not very difficult as long as you are prepared and are ready to move. The difficulty was that you have to be ready for criticism. But you have to know what happens if you give in. If you give in, you lose professionally and the country loses. So this is the first. Under normal politics, you cannot use this extra factor. So you have to engage in communication. So I can tell you what sort of strategies I was using, because I was in charge of Poland's economy in the second period, which was period of normal politics. Normal meaning normal, not very good, no extraordinary factors. And this was between end of 97 and June 2000. I was the leader of the Free Market Party and in a coalition with the umbrella organization under Trade Union Solidarity, and we introduced some substantial reforms. So what was strategy? Be on the offensive first. So be quicker than your opponents. For that you need a very good intelligence and very good communication team. So I hired the best young people. I'll give you an example. We knew that the medical personnel was very critical and they demanded more spending. I was also the Minister of Finance. So what I did, we quickly but professionally prepared a black book on waste in the medical health. And we bombarded the public. So we are on the offensive and they have to defend themselves. So, and we have undercut to some extent their force, their communication force, because we've shown they have a lot of money, they're demanding more money, while they're wasting a lot of money. First. Second, look for the allies. You do not look though for the allies on the respective issues, not only for all the issues. So you may have sometimes strange allies on the respective issues. One of the reforms was to restructure Polish coal mining, which meant massive dismissals, with generous redundancies of payment, but still. By the way, it's possible to win elections while you are a bloody liberal. Don't convince. I was in Silesia, in Poland. Silesia is an industrial region, lots of mining. And I made the decision, I was not from Silesia. There were lots of trade unions, and I decided to compete for a mandate from Silesia as a leader for a free market party. And I have won the mandate, and I have won with a trade union leader from Silesia. And I was not trying to please the miners. I never said, yes, you are so important, we are going to continue subsidizing. Yes, very strategistic. Silesia is not on the mines, it's much more, it's lots of diversification. So it's possible. Now, look for allies. For example, I learned that communities that have the mines, they were not very fond of the mines. Why? Because the mines were not paying taxes to the communities. So you made an alliance with these communities and some other alliances, sometimes strange, exotic, for respective issues. And then be prepared what can happen. Not to be just to be for, not to be surprised. So in Poland we had a huge misuse of subsidies to disabled people. So enterprises which hire disabled people, got subsidies. So it created incentives on the part of employers to look for healthy invalids. Why? Because they were healthy, they were productive, but they got a lot of tax reductions for hiring these say nominal invalids. The lots of money was wasted. And I decided to tackle that. I knew that I was going to be attacked. I knew in what way, and it materialized. These entrepreneurs brought the invalids in the wheelchairs in front of Minister of Finance. There was a lot of TV, etc. They were bombarded, etc. But we knew that they are going to do it. So we are not shocked. And there are some other devices you can use. But to be on the offensive, not to be surprised, to have a good communication team, to be sharp on the issue, I think that's important. And do not feel guilty that you are a liberal. Do not feel guilty. You know that liberals works for the people. Economic freedom is indispensable to improve the lot. So states do not have the high moral ground. It's very important. This is true. It's very important.
Let's put aside public relations for a second. Can you give a few concrete examples of what kind of political opposition you encountered while trying to promote liberalization steps, and how you solved these oppositions?
Well, during the first time, the time of extraordinary politics, there were no massive protests. And the most vocal opponents after a while were the some politicians who came to the conclusion they can get political capital out of demonizing the liberal program and the person who symbolized it, which was my modest person. And they tried. But they has not stopped us for the first 2 years. And if you have 2 years' time, more than 2 years, and you have a very good team, you can do a lot. And we did it. Of course, we have been facing some very aggressive trade unions, which were trying to block highways, to block this was. But they were not very popular in Poland. People who march into Warsaw and block and make life difficult in Warsaw are not supported by most of the inhabitants of Warsaw. So this was not very difficult. The most opposition in the second period came from the political side, you know, in the parliament. So it required a lot of effort sometimes and negotiations to get a bill. And I think my worst setback was that I promoted a tax reform, including flat tax. And first I have to make lots of negotiations and battle within my coalition. And finally they agreed. It was 1998. Then the opposition, the post-communists, tried to block it. And they did not succeed. But it was very tricky. And finally, I was convinced I have won. And the then president of Poland has vetoed this. It was very surprising because he de facto promised not to veto, but he was pressed by his party, post-communist, to do it. So only part of the reform did it. So I think this was not expected from me. This is one of the... Yes, please.
In 93, I think in September 93, The socialists gained the elections, and there was a political consequence, a severe political consequence to the shock therapy.
No, this is a popular conviction, but empirically, no, I explain why it's not. First of all, this was an accident. It did not need to happen in 93. It was like that there was a coalition of solidarity parties with the Solidarity Trade Movement, and there were some quarrels within. And the Solidarity Movement wanted to teach a lesson to the other party, but they did not want to abolish the government. But one or two of their deputies did not appear in the parliament, which was a chance factor, and they lost. So the government was abolished, in a sense, non-confidence voting, and there was a new elections, which did not need to happen, first. But second, it's a popular cliche that if you reform, it's good for a country, but bad for you. By the way, this is the excuse for those who don't want to reform. They say, oh, I would like to reform. But you know, how to win elections? Right. In fact, if you look at the data, almost all cases, parties which have governed in the first period after the collapse of socialists tended to lose elections regardless of whether they reform or not. Why? Because if you inherited a very difficult situation like in Poland and you did reforms, unavoidably, not everybody would be happy. Some people like a quiet life in state-owned enterprises, and all of a sudden you have new private owners which do not allow you to drink vodka on the job. This is the loss of your social right, human right. So they are not very happy. So because of that, there was a tendency, but not 100%, for the reformers to lose elections. But say you inherited a very difficult situation, bad situation, you do not reform. What happens? Situation gets worse. You lose elections. So it's better to reform for a country because there's a chance to win, and certainly a country is better. So if you look at the history of countries which did not reform initially, you see that those who governed in the first period usually lost elections, and they deservedly lost elections. There's also an investigation, more broader, what happens in elections in the OECD countries. It's 50-50. So in the half of the cases there are reformers, half of the cases are not reformers. Very much depends on the situation and on the skills, including the communication skills.
One more?
I'd like to ask back to the phrase that the reforms are good for the country and not good for me. There are professors like Michael Spence and others that have said that there is a problem with capitalism, that it's built into it inequality improperty distribution of the gains of those reforms. So how do the reforms take that into account, the question of distribution of wealth, distribution of the gains of the reforms?
Well, I don't know whether Spence had said it. I would rather suspect Stiglitz would say such a thing. You distinguish between Spence and Stiglitz? No, okay. Stiglitz is less sensible than Spence. Okay, first of all, it's a lot of confusion, huge emotionally loaded confusion in this debate about inequality. Huge. Now, first, to avoid it, one has first to distinguish between inequality of opportunity and inequality of income. Now, what is the best inequality of opportunity? The best degree of inequality of opportunity? Zero. We have an ideal that people with the same intellectual and personality features should have the same chance of achieving their personal goals, yes? And this is a great idea of classical liberalism. So we know what is an idea, I think. What is the best inequality of income? Zero. So should people, regardless of how they work, what do, have the same income? Of course not. So you see the difference. And people usually confuse it. So what should be the best inequality of income? So that people should not earn more than 5 times the average wage? Why? So you don't have, objectively speaking, it is impossible to say directly what is the optimal inequality of income. So you can define it indirectly. If you accept the ideal of inequality of opportunity, then you should accept what results from that. resulting inequality of income. So you should accept that some Hollywood stars earn much more than you, or some gifted football players earn more, etc. Second, there are people who very much are in favor of continued unconventional monetary policy. At the same time, they deplore growing inequalities of income. But continued unconventional monetary policy, to some extent, contributes to inequalities of income, because these policies produce growing prices of securities, of assets. And who benefits more? Not poor people, rich people. So they, at least they should confess that there's a contradiction, but they usually they are not doing that, etc. But there's much more to this discussion. If you moved, you can say that under socialism, inequalities of income are usually less. But there's no hope. And there was huge differences in inequalities of power, difference in power. So there was really, to my knowledge, no protest whatsoever in the post-socialist countries against inequalities of income. Because most people realize, at least until recently, that it is a byproduct of something very good. You can have a better life. And you know, who is distrustful, critical of private ownership? Not workers, some intellectuals. The true founders of socialist ideology were intellectuals. Marx was an intellectual. And if you look at the history of socialists, they were intellectuals, usually social scientists, less physical science, exact sciences. Okay.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks.